our Christmas Eve celebration. My name is Billy Thomas, and I'll be leading you through the worship portion of the service. And you'll find all the words to the music will be up here on the screen as we go through, and we'll try to kind of direct you as we go so that we don't lose anyone along the way. Would you please stand with us as we sing and celebrate the worship of Jesus?
Joyful lantern.
just that chorus part.
Oh, come let us adore Him. Oh, come let us adore Him. Oh, come let us adore
Him. You may be seated. As we light the Christ candle, we are reminded that God has caused this holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. As we taste the fresh true love, this is how much God loved the world that He gave His Son, His one and only Son. And this is why, so that no one need be destroyed. By believing in Him, anyone can have a full and lasting life. Jesus visited this planet as a human being two millennia ago. And He comes to us tonight to give us tonight to enter our hearts in a deeper, fuller way as we taste anew His love. Let's make room for Him and for a fresh experience of His love. As the songwriter says, "Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for You." Dolores, Patrick, on their way. Stand with me as we sing this next song, one of my favorites.
Oh.
Well, it is good to be here. For me and my family, this is the climax of the Christmas season. This is it. This is what Christmas is all about. It's about Jesus. It's about celebrating His birth. And the single greatest way that we do that certainly isn't when we tear into our presents. For us, it's when we gather together with the people of God and the seekers of God. Now, you see that sign, wise men still seek Him? When we gather together, we worship Him, we celebrate His birth, we think about the gift that He gave us. And I hope that you're reflecting upon those same things this evening as we gather together. I'd like to ask you to please bow your head. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we come into your presence, into your holy presence. We bow before you, Lord. Jesus, you came in such a meek and mild manner. So humble, Lord. Lord, you gave up royalty to come for us. Lord, you humbled yourself. That you could be destroyed, beaten for us. Lord, we are humbled when we think about the love that you must have for us. Lord Jesus, we come here, Lord, with different hearts, some young and just enthused, Lord, some, Lord, who are brokenhearted. Some, Lord, who have lived through many Christmases. Lord, we come here in different ways, but we still come before you, Almighty God. And we thank you for the things that you've given us. We thank you, Lord, for the gift that you gave. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that we have. Lord, help us to be grateful. Help us, Lord, to give back to you the one and only thing that we can, which is our heart, our obedience, our love. Those are the only things we can give you. You created everything. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would warm our hearts this evening. I pray for our pastor as he brings the message, Lord. Lord, I just pray that your love would just consume us. In your name we pray, Jesus.
Amen. My name is Carl Fan, and I'm one of the pastors here. What's going on? It's not on. My name is Carl Fannin, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I want to extend a warm welcome to you as well. I'm pleased that you're here tonight and excited that you have made the decision to be with us on this Christmas Eve as we come together for worship. We will, at the end of this hour, be serving communion as a part of the evening, and then having a candle lighting as we sing to close our time together, Silent Night. Just to give you one word of instruction, you may not be able to tell it because of the crowd, but there are four sections here, and communion will be served to all four sections at the same time. The only way this is going to work is if all of us, as we come forward for communion, will move to your right. So that means this group will move along the wall and come this way, and then back to your chair in a circular fashion. This group to your right, to your right, to your right. And there will be four different groups of folks, four different couples serving communion. You'll tear a piece of bread off of the loaf and dip it into the cup, and then move back to your pew, or your seat, excuse me, in a circular fashion. We receive an offering on Christmas Eve. It goes to our church's love fund, and that's the fund that we use to assist people within the church and within the community at large when they have some kind of a financial need. We help people with our love fund in terms of food purchases and utility bills, rent. There's a variety of ways that our love fund is tapped and used over the course of any given year. We know that tonight there are a lot of family members with us, and you perhaps are from out of town, and we hope that you enjoy the time here with your family, and then of course tomorrow as well. If you are visiting with us from this community, just to encourage you, if you're not already a part of a church family, consider being part of this one. We worship each Sunday morning in this building at 8 and 11, and at the West Heartland building at 9:30. Our ushers should be stepping out and coming this way, and we'll receive that evening.
Darkest storm. The third tree said, someday I wish to remain a tree. But not just any tree. I want to grow so straight and so tall that I will tower above the clouds. And all who pass this hill will see me standing here, pointing the way to heaven.
Years passed.
Seasons came and went.
Then one day three woodsmen came up the hill carrying axes.
They cut down the first tree.
They cut down the second tree.
They cut down the third tree.
And the first tree was carried to a carpenter's shop, where it was stripped of its bark, trimmed of its branches, and it was made into a box. But not the treasure chest of a wealthy man. It was made into a feed box for animals and placed in a barn.
The second tree was carried to a dockyard. There it too was stripped of its bark, trimmed of its branches, and was made into part of a boat. But not the mast of a great sailing ship. It was carved into a wooden bench and nailed in the back of a fishing vessel.
And the third tree, when it was stripped of its bark and trimmed of its branches, proved to be too flawed even for common usage. And it was covered with a top and laid aside in the lumber yard.
More years passed. Seasons came and went. And then one day, into the barn where the first tree lay, now a feed box for animals,
there came a young woman.
And a young man.
And that night, the woman had her firstborn child. And she wrapped him in warm cloths and laid him in the box. And the dream of the first tree came true. For that night she held a treasure more precious than any in the world.
More years passed. Then one day, into the boat where the second tree was now a wooden bench, there stepped a young teacher. The boat was sailed to the middle of a lake. There the young man fell asleep on the bench with his head on a cushion. A terrible storm arose. Waves crashed over the side of the boat. The fishermen on board, in fear for their lives, awoke the man who stood and with one word silenced the wind and calmed the waves. And the dream of the second tree came true. For that day he had carried the king of all kings.
And what of the third tree? Well, one day soldiers came and found that tree and laid it across the back of a wounded man who struggled to the top of a tall hill where the tree was planted once again.
And the dream of the third tree came true,
for it towered above all else.
And all who passed the hill that day
and who have passed it since can see
that it points the way to heaven.
Not told its truth to be received by faith, not to fruit, but to this fruit of the true and the living God became one of us, but in the person of Jesus Christ. Beginning as a baby inside of a manger, he would carry a cross in an act of divine love to open up a way of salvation for those who, in repentant faith, would be willing to receive it. It almost seems as if we as a culture are more excited about being the followers of a wizard than of the one who prophetically was called a wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. But not tonight. And not in this place, because we've come together in order to celebrate the gift of God in Christmas. The angel said to those shepherds, I bring you good news of great joy, which is for all people. Tonight, in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Note in the angel's words, the news, the need, and the name. I bring you good news, the angel said. We as a people are once again in need of news that is good. It seems as if this fall has brought upon us the kind of news in a daily way that we are glued to, but none of it is the kind of good news that we wanted to have to receive. We are once again a people who seem to be desperate for good news. I tell you a joke that I run the risk of perhaps offending some of you in telling. If it offends you, please forgive me. It perhaps will not offend others, but it's a joke that comes to me from our own Betty Colonel by way of an email. It seems that recently the Marine that was guarding the White House was approached by a man who said, I'd like to see President Clinton. And the Marine very politely said, I'm sorry, but President Bush is our president now. And the gentleman said, oh, and left. And the next day, the same man came back and said to the same Marine, I'd like to see President Clinton. And the Marine said, once again, President Bush is our president now. And the man said, oh, and came back the next day, the third day in a row, and said to the same Marine, I'd like to see President Clinton. And the Marine, a little bit frustrated, a little bit put out with this the stranger who had come by, said to him, this is the third day in a row that I've told you that President Bush is our president, that President Clinton is no longer in office. And the man said, I know, I just wanted to hear it again. Some news is worth repeating, and some news is worth hearing over and over, and some news you never tire of hearing it again. The angel said, I bring you good news of great joy. For this day in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. It's a story that we don't tire repeating. It's news that needs to be repeated and sounded again and again. I bring you good news of great joy. For this day, the city of David, a Savior. The news is of a Savior, but even implied in that word, Savior is the need. A Savior is one needed for rescue. A Savior is one needed for redemption in a situation where the stakes are life and death. The word isn't wizard. The angel didn't say, I bring you news of a wizard that has been born. But the angel said, I bring you news of a Savior. Implied in the very word is its need. It doesn't involve fellowship with a ring that's been lost. but fellowship in relationship with the living God that has been damaged and that leaves all of us lost in sin. It is good news that is announced that there is a Savior, and that Savior has been supplied. His name, Christ the Word. The angel said that in bringing this word of good news. Christ the Lord. His name is Emmanuel. The choir sang it for us. Of God with us. His name is Jesus. And it is that Jesus that after carrying a cross later on would be nailed to it as an act of divine love, giving his life as a means of making a way of forgiveness and acceptance and deliverance and new life, in other words, salvation possible. It is that Jesus announced as Christ the Lord to the shepherds on the Bethlehem plain, born and laid in that box inside of the manger, that would later on carry a cross and be nailed to it as an act of divine love to make possible and to open up a way of forgiveness, acceptance with God, deliverance from the demonic, new life, in other words, make a way of salvation, because he's the Savior, because he's the way. And the truth, and the life. The world has witnessed the incarnation of unimaginable evil this fall. That's what it was, and that's what we all witnessed. We may not really realize that, but we have witnessed this fall the incarnation of unimaginable evil. An evil that the Bible says is one that has taken captive human nature. All of us, an evil that has taken captive our natures, and the nature of every person that has ever been born, so that we all need a Savior. We all need one to redeem us, to rescue us, and that Savior is Jesus, who is the incarnation of the great, great love of God. God Himself becoming flesh, taking a body like ours to demonstrate his great love for us in that cross, opening up a way for our forgiveness and our acceptance with him, deliverance from our own nature, and providing us with new life. This evening, I invite you to embrace, maybe for the first time, that Savior for yourself. Or I invite you this evening to reaffirm in faith that Savior as your Savior. Have you seen the TV commercial that's been running over the past several weeks suggesting that you might want to give someone a Lexus as a Christmas gift? That car, you know, that's very, very expensive. Have you seen that TV commercial? It suggests that what you might want to do is give someone a Lexus as a gift. I think it's a pretty neat commercial. I like that commercial. It has several different segments to it, and all of them seem to imply, in the course of watching the commercial, that the person in the commercial, thinking that the gift of this Lexus is for someone else, the news is suddenly announced that the gift is for them. My favorite inside of the commercial is the family that announces that the gift to their daughter is a new CD player. That's the part of the commercial that I like the best. They're going to give their daughter a new CD player, and then the news is announced that this CD player comes wrapped in the body of this Lexus. And she, of course, as you can imagine, is elated. The gift of God's love. The gift of God's love is both hidden and revealed. Cloaked in something else to be announced. For wrapped inside the body of a baby. Wrapped in something else. The gift is not easily discerned at times. It's both concealed and revealed. But it's wrapped inside of the body of a baby. God Himself came to be our Savior. A Savior that we need, a Savior whose news is announced at Christmas, but a Savior whose power to save us from sin is accomplished at the cross. The news is announced at Christmas, but the power to save us from our sins is accomplished in his cross. Communion rehearses the cross in the shadow of the baby born in Bethlehem. That's why we would incorporate communion into Christmas Eve. It rehearses this cross in the shadow of that baby born in Bethlehem. For you see, in the night that that same baby was betrayed, later on, in that same night, he took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said to them, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And he also took a cup that night and said to them, "This cup is my blood," of a new covenant, a new way that a person could find a relationship with the living God. "This is my blood of that new way that is shed for many for remission of sins." Let's pray. Father, as we think this evening of your great love for us and of the extraordinary lengths that you have gone to demonstrate that love, gone to those lengths at Christmas, and gone to those extraordinary lengths at the cross, we marvel at that. They're really